Good morning. My name's Alec, and I'm excited to welcome everyone to worship at Asbury this morning on a beautiful summer morning. I want to take just a moment to welcome any first-time guests that are here with us this morning and say that we are very excited to have you with us. We would love the opportunity to connect with you, get in touch with you, and we have a couple of ways that we can do that. Option one is you can pull out a connection card, which you can find in the seat back pocket in front of you. If you want to fill that out during service and drop it in the offering plate during offertory, that's a great way to get in contact. Or option two is you can pull out your cell phones and text the word welcome to 281-305-1069. After you send that message, you'll receive a follow-up text to fill out the same info that's on that quick connection card, but just online instead. Save a tree, you know, be the future. But don't worry, we won't sell your information to AI. If you are a first-time guest, go ahead and stop by our welcome desk on your way out of worship this morning so we can give you a small gift as a way of saying thanks for being here. Once again, my name is Alec. If you need someone to talk to after worship, I'm right back there in the media booth. Without further ado, let's get ready to worship and let's welcome a special message from the one, the only... Ta-da!
Thank you, but I think you could do better. Good morning. I'm Keith Palmer, if you don't know me. I'm the chairman of our Staff Parish Relations Committee, and fortunately, one of the honors I get is to recognize our pastor when she does a great job, and she gives me so many opportunities to do that, but I know she doesn't like this part, but Lindsay, would you come up here, please? It's been our privilege and honor to have you serve as our pastor now going on 11 years, correct? To do that, we just had our annual conference. Very good. And I can honestly say, because I've been here a really long time, I have never seen a pastor work as hard for the Lord and for our church and our congregation as you have these years. We've seen you grow. You've had your family come here. You've been such a blessing to our church. The things that we have done, I was trying to think this morning, what this place looked like when you arrived, not just physically look like, but the enthusiasm and the commitment to our community. It has grown so much. We've gone through COVID. We've gone through all sorts of growth that we've done, and now we've got Parkwood and that possibility, and I can't think of a better leader to help us guide through that. So I know early service, we don't stand up very often, but let's stand up and welcome her back for another year. And now it's time for Kay in the choir. There you go.
Our opening hymn today is Faith of Our Fathers. It is page 710 in the hymnal if you like to follow along with the music. Those of you that are at home, we want you to join with us. It's on your screen, on your device at home. So please sing with us. I want to say happy Father's Day to all of the fathers in our congregation, and not just to the fathers, but to the men who show an example to our children of what it is to be a godlike person. We appreciate you. If the congregation will stand as you're able, we will all join in singing together.
Oh, how our hearts beat.
Please remain standing for our affirmation of faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. I want to invite any kids that are in the sanctuary up to the front. Say a big hello to any friends worshiping with us at home today. Good morning, friends. Okay. So I recently went to an end of the year dance recital. In one of the performances, it was a class of three-year-olds. The curtains open and they all looked terrified. They were like, right? And the music started and most of them just stood there kind of frozen, not knowing really what to do. But there was one little girl who was really getting down to the music. She was spinning around and doing all the movements to all of the things that they had probably practiced over the last 4 months, right? She was on fire, let me tell you. But I noticed when she was doing it, the whole time she kept her head to the left. She was doing all the dance moves and really getting down and boogieing, but she was always looking to the left, no matter what they were doing. So come to find out, her mom was behind the curtain on the left side, right? And as long as that little girl could see her mommy, then she was brave and she danced like no one else was watching. She felt safe and she was able to follow through on that dance routine. Our Bible message today in Judges chapter 6, that's in the Old Testament, tells of a man named Gideon who was scared of what God was telling him to do. But after trusting that God would never leave him, he was able to follow through. Now, he didn't boogie down like the little girl, but he followed through on what God was telling him to do. Now, God's people at that time, they kept disobeying God, not following his rules, and their enemies, called the Midianites, they were stealing their food and supplies. So God sent an angel down to Gideon, telling him that he would be the leader to save the people. Gideon was afraid and scared and didn't think he was good enough, didn't think he was rich enough, and didn't think he was important enough to do this. So Gideon asked God for signs to help him believe. And God gave Gideon those signs to reassure him and promised to always be with him the whole time. So Gideon gathered all the men that he could find. And after all the Midianites had lots of soldiers. So it's only natural that Gideon should have lots of soldiers too, right? But God disagreed and told Gideon that he had way too many soldiers. So he started with 32,000 soldiers, and then it dropped to 10,000. And then God told Gideon that even 10,000 soldiers was too many. God told Gideon to have his men get a drink of water from the river, and if they lapped it up with their tongues like a dog, have y'all seen a dog drink water? Yep. Then they were not to be part of the army. Only 300 men were left after this. So when nighttime came, it was time for battle, Gideon gave his 300 men torches, trumpets, and empty clay jars. Now I'm sure the men were like, where's our swords for battle? How are we to fight with those three things? But Gideon trusted God, and when Gideon was ready, he broke his jar, blew his trumpet, and all the men did the same. And the enemy, the Midianites, didn't know what was happening, and they started freaking out, and they all started fighting each other, and they ran away in fear. And the battle was won by Gideon and his men by breaking jars, blowing trumpets, and yelling. Now, only God can do that, right? Only God can win a battle like that. So Gideon started out as someone with not a whole lot of faith, but lots of fear. And fear, it fights our faith, and we need faith in God to fight fear back. That's hard to say, isn't it? So with faith, we get strength from God, and we can't see faith, but we can see what comes from faith, like strength to keep going even if you fail at something, or courage to try something new that you've never done before, or peace of mind when you're having to go into a new classroom, self-control when things don't go our way. But even if we have faith and trust in God, we still get afraid sometimes, right? And that's okay. We can't always get rid of our fear because that's a human feeling, right? Sometimes fearing something keeps us safe, like having a healthy fear of fire so we don't get burned. But even if we are afraid, we can still try to step out in faith and talk to God about it, just like Gideon did. God gave Gideon faith to overcome his fear, and God does this for us too. When we feel scared or weak, God will give us what we need, and we can trust that he will never leave us. So as we worship, learn more about God, serve others, and share Christ, our faith becomes stronger and stronger because God fills us up with all of that. God uses our experiences, our strengths, and our weaknesses to make us stronger and helps us through anything. So if you feel scared or unsure, remember Gideon and how God provided for him, and he will take care of you too. Will you guys pray with me now? Dear God, thank you for your love. Help us remember that you are always with us when we are scared like Gideon was. And help us be willing to trust in you no matter what. In Jesus' name we pray, and together we all say, amen. Great job, guys.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to be in worship with you today. Would you please stand and greet one another in the love and peace of Jesus Christ? And also with you. Peace. Thank you. Peace. Thank you. Good morning, peace. All right, friends, let's go ahead and get back to our seats. Elena Parmer's asked for some prayers, and Dennis Humphrey asked for you to pray for his continued recovery, too. Let's go ahead and bow our heads and our hearts as we go to the Lord in prayer today. Father God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for the surprising blessings that we see if we'll all just open our eyes to them. Today, we thank you for Father's Day. Lord, you know that sometimes as a parent, fathers, we just want things to be easy for one day. And yet they keep doing the hard thing day after day after day. We thank you for that. We pray, Lord, that you would help them to see being a dad as a ministry, that you would equip them, strengthen them, help them to keep going with joy and purpose, that they would share the unconditional love of our Father with their own children. We thank you for that, God. We take a moment and thank you for our own fathers. We thank you for the good. We thank you for the not so good. We thank you for all that you've taught us through them. We pray a blessing on them. Today, God, we think about what it's like to go out on a limb with you. And sometimes we like to stay in the shallow waters where we can walk and step and choose where we go. But today we ask, Lord, we have the courage to say, take us out into the deep waters where we cannot step and where we have to be pulled and pushed by your current, Holy Spirit. Help us not to rely on our own strength, but yours alone. And to have the courage to go where you take us. This morning, we lift up all of the concerns that we come in the door with this morning. Another round of mass shootings that we learned about overnight. We pray blessings on those families, that you would give them comfort, that you would help lead us to ways of decreasing these. For all the people in our lives, our loved ones, our neighbors, our enemies who are going through struggle, we pray, Lord, that you would bless them with the feeling of your hand on their shoulder. Carry them when they need to be carried. Help them to know you are with them. We ask that you would forgive us of our sins. We ask also, Lord, that you would make our sins very obvious and plain to us, not as a way of guilting us, but just so that we can feel more deeply the unconditional nature of your love for us when you offer us the grace and forgive us again. Thank you for that. Lord, we are ready to be on a mission. We are ready to go where you send us. And so we pray that as we go throughout this week ahead, that we be looking for where you're calling us to go. We be listening for your words speaking direction into our lives, and that you would fill us up to overflowing with confidence in your good work in the world. We ask that you would bless the gifts that are about to be given, and that you would use them for your purposes and not our own. And we pray all this in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, in just a moment, when the music begins, you'll have an opportunity to place offerings in the offering plates by the back doors here in the sanctuary. There's lots of other ways to give online, too. You know, God is doing a lot of incredible ministry through this church, and every time you give, you're a part of that. Thank you.
Thank you. words from Deuteronomy chapter 31. Be strong, be fearless, don't be afraid, and don't be scared by your enemies, because the Lord your God is the one who marches with you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well done, Larissa. Thank you. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for scripture, and as we read your word today, we pray that you would speak to us once again, God. We are listening. Holy Spirit, come. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I happen to be a sucker for underdogs. When it comes to the Super Bowl, the way I decide who I'm rooting for is I ask who has won less, and that's who I go for. One day when the Texans make it, my strategy will shift, I promise. But till then, I just kind of love underdogs. There's something about the victory going to the one who it's least expected from and who least expects it themselves, who doesn't feel entitled to it, who works and perseveres with the hope that maybe, somehow, they will succeed. Whether it's Frodo or Nemo, Arlo or Lilo, I love it when someone you wouldn't expect ends up conquering. I think we all like to cheer on an underdog. We don't think they're worth less just because they've had a harder journey. And yet, we think that we need to be strong. It's on our shoulders. We've got to tough it out. We are the overcomers. We're the leaders. We are the doers who have it all figured out. Even though, have you noticed, nobody ever roots for that guy. And if we can't do it all on our own, if we're feeling like we don't have it all together, if we're feeling a little helpless, actually, we equate that with being less than, bad, not as good as, worse, weak. A couple times this summer, we're looking at stories of strength and courage in the Bible. Last week, we looked at the life of Abigail, a kick-butt prophet from the Old Testament, who met 400 warriors on a field one day and turned them all around. Today, we're looking at the life of a guy named Gideon, and we think of him today as a mighty judge of Israel. But if you pay attention to his story, you're going to notice he's like the biggest underdog anywhere. So join with me if you will. We're going to read in Judges chapter 6 this morning. That's towards the very beginning of your Bible. After the first five books, those are called the books of Moses, then you have Joshua, and then you have Judges. Just a quick history lesson, a reminder that once the Israelites came up out of Egypt and finally landed in the Promised Land, they did not have a king. Instead, they had a series of judges, and most of the judges were actually just warrior generals who would fight their local oppressors. The only judge who actually acted the way we think of a judge today was Deborah. You can read her story a couple chapters earlier. This is Judges chapter 6, beginning in verse 1. The Israelites did things that the Lord saw as evil, and the Lord handed them over to the Midianites for 7 years. This is where you, in Judges, you see the redemption cycle more than anywhere else. You have the sin here, they did evil, and then the consequences, the Lord handed them over. The power of the Midianites prevailed over Israel, and because of the Midianites, the Israelites used crevices and caves in the mountains as hidden strongholds. Whenever the Israelites planted seeds, the Midianites, Amalekites, and other Easterners would invade. They would set up camp against the Israelites and destroy the land's crops as far as Gaza, leaving nothing to keep Israel alive, not even sheep, oxen, or donkeys. They would invade with their herds and tents, coming like a swarm of locusts so that no one could count them or their camels. They came into the land in order to destroy it. So Israel became very weak on account of Midian, And the Israelites cried out to the Lord. That's that repentance part of the cycle. Skip down to verse 11. Then the Lord's messenger came and sat under the oak at Ophrah that belonged to Joash the Abiezrite. His son Gideon was threshing wheat inside a wine press to hide it from the Midianites. The Lord's messenger appeared to him and said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." But Gideon replied to him, "With all due respect, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his amazing works that our ancestors recounted to us, saying, 'Didn't the Lord bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has abandoned us and allowed Midian to overpower us." Then the Lord turned to him and said, "You have strength. So go and rescue Israel from the power of Midian. Am I not personally sending you?" But again, Midian said to him, "With all due respect, my Lord, how can I rescue Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I'm the youngest in my household." The Lord replied, "Because I'm with you. Because I'm with you. You'll defeat the Midianites as if they were just one person." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. How is Gideon an underdog? Let us count the ways. When we meet Gideon, he's hiding in a hole in the ground. Every time the Israelites turned around, the Midianites were coming in and wiping them out. Every new crop, they'd come in and take it all the animals, all the crops. This is not just about oppression, it is about starvation. They are working to systematically wipe Israel out. And the fact that this is still some version of this, a story over there so many thousands of years later, is heartbreaking in all directions. When a kid comes home with a test that has a big fat F at the top in red marker, and the parent says, "You're the smartest kid in the world," it doesn't really ring true, does it? The kid doesn't trust what the parent is saying. Either the parent is being sarcastic, in the worst case, or it's untrue flattery in the best case. And that's what I think Gideon is feeling here in this story. He's hiding in a hole, and the angel calls him a mighty warrior. Yeah, right. Salt in an open wound. That's weakness number one. And the angel tells him, "The Lord is with you." And Gideon basically says, "Yeah, right. Again, what about the present?" Convinces you of God's presence. You know those moments in life? When nothing that's happening seems like God is at work at all. So not only is he humiliated that he's having to hide in a hole in the ground, but there is no recent evidence that God is with them either. He's feeling lonely, apart from God. It's enough to make anyone feel defeated. But that's not all. Manasseh was probably the largest tribe in terms of land mass. This is an example. And it's the kind of darker green in the north on both sides of the Jordan River. That was Manasseh territory, okay? So they have a lot of territory, but it was not a tribe known for leadership. Nobody expected that to come from Manasseh. In fact, it never really ever did again, except through Gideon. And to be the weakest clan out of a large number of weak options is really saying something. And in a culture where power, wealth, prestige went from the eldest to the youngest in a straight downward line, Gideon is from the weakest clan of a weak tribe, and he's the youngest in the family. Things are not stacking up well for him, okay? So let's make it worse. If you continue to read Gideon's story, and I encourage you to do so, these couple of chapters, it's very there's a lot of meat there. You discover that his family were actually idol worshipers. Awesome. They had a little god on this side and a little Asherah on that side and a little Baal on the other. Perfect conditions. He can't even be proud of his family before the Lord. So there's shame as a defeated people from Midianite oppression. There's shame as the youngest and the weakest culturally. There's shame as an unfaithful family. This is the last place on earth you would expect the power and faithfulness of God to show up. God only works when things are neat and polished and fixed and perfect, right? We've got to get ourselves right before God is able to accept us or use us. So it's no wonder that Gideon asks permission to test God. By the way, not a bad idea. We've talked many times before about how testing God is a fine idea. God encourages it all the time in the Bible. Put me to the test, he actually said. But Gideon asks for permission. And I think that shows some humility. It's good to ask God if this is an okay time to test him. So he does. And the angel says, sure. And so Gideon brings an offering and places it down. The angel touches his staff to the offering, and it instantly burns up. And Gideon is afraid. He's like, oh no, this is real. I'm in trouble. And the angel, the messenger, says, peace, don't be afraid. And so Gideon builds an altar there and called it the Lord Makes Peace. So Gideon goes and he destroys the altars that his family has set up to Baal and to Asherah. Baal was the male god. Asherah was the female god of the local Canaanites. And the town gets up in arms and they want to kill him. But his dad stands up for him. And Gideon begins to make a name for himself as a person of conviction and courage. So the scripture says that the Spirit of the Lord then came over Gideon. And when the Midianites start gathering for another battle, Gideon gathers Israel together too. Here he is. He's actually stepping out with the Lord, growing in courage, about to test his newfound strength. And he's nervous. And he's wondering if he's really doing the right thing. He has no battle experience at all. What if he's wrong and he gets all of these fathers and sons killed? So he tests God again. You know, sometimes we feel like if we need to test God, that must mean that our faith is weak. But it doesn't seem to bother God that Gideon is testing him. Maybe that means he doesn't mind it when we test him either. Gideon does this thing where he lays a piece of fleece out overnight and asks God to have the fleece covered in morning dew, but the ground to be completely dry. And then that's not good enough. So then the next day he does it in reverse, and God goes along with whatever it is that Gideon needs in order to feel strong and courageous. So it's finally time for battle. The showdown is finally here, and Gideon has amassed 32,000 soldiers, enough to feel like they really might have a chance for once against this enemy who has used overwhelming force to decimate them over and over again. And do you know what God says? So now, announce in the people's hearing, anyone who's afraid or unsteady, go ahead and return home from Gideon's mountain. And at this, 22,000 people went home out of fear. And 10,000 were left. And the Lord said to Gideon, you still have too many on your side. If I were to hand Midian over to them, the Israelites might claim credit for themselves rather than for me, thinking we saved ourselves. But that's not all. Take a look at what's next. The Lord said to Gideon, there are still too many people. Take them down to the water. I will weed them out for you there. Whenever I tell you this one will go with you, he should go with you. But whenever I tell you this one won't go with you, he should not go. So he took the people down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, set aside those who lap the water with their tongues as a dog laps, from those who bend down on their knee to drink. The number of men who lapped was 300, and all the rest of the people bent down on their knee to drink water with their hands to their mouths. God puts Gideon in a position that makes him weaker, so that God's strength becomes undeniable. Gideon goes from an army of 32,000 soldiers to the 300 idiots who lap water like dogs instead of scooping it up with their hands like a person with a, you know, You know when you feel like you're holding it all together with like duct tape and some fishing line in your life? And then on top of the hiding in a hole and the family of idol worshipers and the weakest clan of a tribe nobody expects leadership from, the youngest in the whole family, a man who feels the need to test God instead of take it on blind faith, going from leading an army to a ragtag group, God sends them into battle with trumpets and empty jars. And they win. They win. Gideon wasn't strong. He did not have gobs of courage like Abigail. When he gets up to the plate, everybody knows he has no chance. And that worked out great for God. Because then, when God did something powerful and incredible through him, everybody would know it wasn't because of Gideon. God used Gideon's weakness as an advantage to reveal the evidence of God's strength. And I imagine there are times or places in all of our lives where we have felt defeated, and maybe you even do now. And you don't see any proof that God is present in the present. You have felt like a coward, maybe. You haven't always walked with the Lord the way you know you should. You've given up hope that God could turn it around. Why would he use you anyway? You don't have to muster up the strength and the courage from within yourself. It's not a get up by your bootstraps situation. Get to know the Lord. Test him the way Gideon did. Don't be surprised if it gets a little worse before it gets better. Like from 32,000 to 300. Maybe God is testing us like we test him. Do you trust me? Can you stick with me when it feels like all the odds are stacked against you? But in the end, it's Gideon, of all people, who's the one willing to lead 300 dummies into battle against their enemies and win. Because in the end, he went all in on God's strength and courage. And you can too. I tell people all the time that when I arrived at Asbury, it reminded me a little bit of an old children's book, maybe not in the best way. Do you remember the book, The Little Engine That Could? Well, the church had recently gone through a bit of a season when I arrived here in 2014, and instead of thinking that it could, I think I can, it seemed to me at the time that Asbury was climbing up a hill saying to itself, I think I can't. When we would talk about what could be here, the answers were often that we didn't have a big enough building. We didn't have enough people. We didn't have enough leaders. And the big one that trips a lot of us up, we didn't have enough money. And so instead of thinking that the church could, the church seemed to think that it couldn't. And then God began to take things and run with them. A hard conversation about church finances led to the creation of a new community outreach we called Frozen Winter Wonderland. And as I got to know people better, I realized there were incredible leaders right here just waiting to be tapped. And the biggest thing of all that made the difference was that every time somebody raised an idea, instead of saying no, people said, well, let's just see what God will do with that. And so, the little church that couldn't became the church running on the power of, I think God can. And God took something that thought of itself as weak and said, perfect, I can do a whole lot with that. As most of you know, I came back from General Conference a month ago on a mission. I had learned earlier that Christians in Eastern Congo, a region called North Katanga, didn't have Bibles to read. Pastors led worship, Bible studies from what they could remember from the Bible because they didn't have enough money to buy one. I happened to sit down at dinner one night next to a man that I was amazed to discover was the director of evangelism for that annual conference, and I asked him about this, and he said, yes, Bibles and bicycles, big needs. And I asked him why about the bicycles, and he said that in his area there are very few roads, so bicycles can get through the brush better than cars can, and many pastors don't own a bike, So they walk. They walk to church every day for work. They walk to church members' homes. And they have no way to get people to the hospital because riding on the back of a bike is the main way to accomplish that. So I turned this need over to you, who for many years had been saying, I think God can, I think God can, I think God can. And you handled it. I mean, this one smallish but mighty congregation is the reason that 500 churches and thousands of people are soon going to have access to the Word of God. Here's the part you don't know. This week, I was at annual conference. And the chair of our delegation invited me to tell this story during his report to the annual conference on Monday afternoon. And I was happy to. I told him all about it. And when I finished, Reverend Kip Gilt, some of you may remember him as the one who's baptized my sons, went to the microphone and challenged the annual conference to complete the need by donating funds for all the bicycles, too. Now, I had hoped that we would be able to accomplish that over the course of about a year, somehow. He held up a check and gave the first donation, and he read Hebrews 10:24, "Let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds." And he said that I and Asbury had provoked him, and now he wanted to provoke everybody else. And the money started pouring in. On Tuesday, everywhere I walked, people were handing me money. This is not a problem I've had many times in my life. On Tuesday afternoon, the pastor of Bay Harbor over in League City went to the microphone and pledged 10 bicycles and challenged the UMC over in Dickinson to do the same, and they did. On Wednesday, the pastor of St. Paul's UMC, the church right next to the Museum of Fine Arts downtown, went to the microphone and said, people were so close, let's just finish this by the end of annual conference. And he stayed at the microphone until he had enough hands raised to take care of the rest of it. All the money was raised. And then the coolest part happened. A layperson from the other church, United Methodist Church in League City, who happens to be a friend of the daughter of Billy Joe Riley, came to the microphone and made a motion that the conference missions team explore the possibility of forming an ongoing ministry relationship with North Katanga, and it passed unanimously. Then we took a picture so that we could send it to our brothers and sisters in the Congo. I don't remember anything like this ever having happened at annual conference before. How many thousands of people are going to be brought to salvation because 500 churches have access to the Word? How many people's lives are going to be preserved because they can get to the hospital on the back of a pastor's bike? Where else might God take this? I think God can. I think God can. I think God can. And all that happened because of little old Asbury. Sometimes as fathers, as mothers, as employees and neighbors and church members, we feel like we've messed things up so bad that nothing is possible anymore. Maybe God could do something through somebody better, someone who hadn't failed so badly, but not through us. Friends, that's bull. It just means that you don't remember Gideon. Or worse, you don't believe that God is capable of doing that through you. And any time that we believe that our limits are greater than God's power, we've got ourselves mixed up. So friends, say this with me. God's power,
is greater than my limits.
God can do anything God wants to. Even through me. It might just be that you feeling weak is the perfect condition for God to be strong. So if you're feeling a little low on strength and courage, talk to the Lord the way that Gideon did. Be honest. As for permission to put God to the test, you can ask for it. And if God gives it to you, then do it. And then don't wait to feel strong before you are willing to step out with the Lord. Right in the place of your weakness, maybe even when you feel at your weakest, the way Gideon did, jump. and discover that the Lord's strength and courage will carry the day. Let's pray together. God, thank you for this story that, you know, comes from, 3,000 years ago, actually more. And yet, we see ourselves, hopefully, in this story. We thank you that Gideon was willing to go into battle with 300. He didn't feel any stronger or more courageous than he did when he was hiding in that wine press, but he decided that the Lord's strength was enough. And so help us too. Whenever you're leading us out to a place where we can't even touch the bottom anymore, help us to give up. Give up grasping for our own power and strength, and instead go all in on yours, Lord. Thank you for the evidence that you continue to work powerful things through those who are weak. And we offer ourselves so that you can do it again. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Our closing hymn is "He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought," page 128 in the hymnal. If you're at home, please sing along with us from your screen. Congregation, stand as you're able, and we will all sing together.
Thank you.
Well, I'm so glad that we got to worship together today, and I hope we get to see each other again next Sunday. Couple things we want to let you know about. The next meeting of our Asbury United Methodist men's group is this Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, and they would love to have any men who are here at Asbury to be a part of that. If you have questions, Gordon, can you raise your hand? This is the fellow you want to talk to right over here, okay? All right. Also, if you're interested in joining the church or learning more about it or asking any questions about Asbury, I'd love to meet with you for a chat next Sunday between services at 10 o'clock for our Next Steps meeting. It'll be right down the hall on the left, and we'll have some refreshments and a conversation together. I'd love to see you there. This Wednesday night at 6:30, the youth group is going to Tutti Frutti for some froyo, and they would love to have y'all, any youth 6th through 12th grade, 6:30 to 7:30 this Wednesday night. We also have a young adults group for 20-somethings here in our church. They meet at Mama Mia's over on Spencer, and it's this Wednesday at 6:30 as well. They would love to have y'all for that. Okay, so on the 21st and the 23rd, later this week, we're having work days to kind of get ready for Vacation Bible School, which is next week, believe it or not. And if you are available, maybe you can't help out during the week of VBS, but you could help us get some of the prep work done ahead of time. We'd love to have your help either of those days. Another thing that's coming up we're real excited about, this week we'll be sharing a picture. A few months ago, I asked the youth how they would like to be more involved in the church. Some folks said they wanted to help out in the sound booth. Others said they wanted to help read scripture. One of our students asked for an unpaid summer internship. And so Sylvia Rooney is starting her internship this week, and she, one of the things for her internship is she's going to be leading a Bible study for high schoolers. It's going to start July 9th, and it's called Made by God. And so if there are any high schoolers that are looking for a Bible study, she'll be excited to have them on Tuesday nights. Also, save the date, August 19th and 20th, photo directory pictures. We're actually going to start sending out the link to be able to sign up for your slot this week. So if you have a specific time you want, I encourage you to sign up early. We have prayer partners, and they're going to be coming forward as service closes so that they can pray for you today. If you'd like to have someone pray with you, I hope you have just the best week ahead and a wonderful rest of your Father's Day. And I also pray that if there's a time this week that you're feeling weak, you would remember that God goes before you to show you the way, behind you to keep you moving, above you to watch over you, beside you to befriend you, and within you always to give you peace. Amen.